All right, brothers and sisters, how are y'all this evening?
All right.
So, bow your head, I'm going to lead us in a word of prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, thank you for all you've given us, dear Lord. And just thank you for this day of worship that we had, the service and the message that you brought to us this morning. Dear Lord, I pray that we're just doers of your words and not hearers only. Lord, I just pray for all the ones that are mentioned on the prayer list. I pray you just touch each and every one of their lives. Draw closer to you, dear Lord. Show them your love, your mercy, and your healing power, dear Lord. And I pray you just open our hearts to hear from you tonight, dear Lord. I pray that we just worship and praise you with all of our strength and all of our might, dear Lord. And we love you so much. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
We'll get y'all to turn to page 250 in the Brown Hymnal, page 250. Page 250, we're going to sing the first, second, fourth verse of Send the Light, and y'all be thinking of a testimony y'all like to share.
Jesus.
think about that little boy on social media who's saying, punched me. You know, instead of he plunged me, he punched me. And that's how we are sometimes. We have to be, I know me personally, I have to be punched. You know, God has to say, hey, come on, Melissa, you know, you got to do this.
Amen.
And every time he's saying that, I think about that little boy.
Yeah. All right, anyone else? You got page number? About 179. Say the same thing.
Amen.
And if you don't know, after this morning's sermon, you had your hearing aid shut off or you wasn't paying attention. That's all I
got
to say.
Amen, brother.
All right. Anyone else? All right. We're going to sing 120.
I got something I'm going to say. Okay. I was thinking as we were singing those verses, those songs, that, you know, sometimes we just get to singing the words and we don't even think about what the words mean because you've sang it so many times. You come to really think about it, think what Jesus really did for us.
Amen.
You know? Just think about it. Just don't let it be, I'm just singing this song and we get it over with. Mm. Think about the words.
Amen.
Sing it to the Lord. You know?
Amen. Amen. All right, we'll turn to page 126. We're going to sing the first, second, fourth verse about the cross, and then the Tim McCaslin band will be coming up in a little bit for us. So y'all be in prayer for them.
Hold on a minute. I'm going to find that in a different version.
four sharps.
It could be four dolls and we would look at it.
I like sharps. I really like all flats and sharps.
Four darts, what's a dart?
A dart. He said, what's a dart?
What's a dart? Not a dart, a sharp.
What's all about, that's what I'm saying.
Okay, not really.
That don't look like dogs to me.
Jim said something a while ago that I don't even remember what he said now. anyway, it reminded me.
I don't either.
I've known Jim a good while, and I love him to pieces. But he said, he made me think about, do you know Jesus? And I do, and I'm thankful for it. And, you know, time here on this earth is short. And we need to know, and we need to testify to that, we need to witness to that each and every day. And I pray that I will, and I pray that I show the happiness that I have in the Lord. Amen. And the love that He has for me, that I can show others, and show my wife Sherry and my friend Sherry. I messed up this morning at church, and anyway, we won't get into that, but I didn't. I loved everybody but her.
Anyway, you telling everybody you loved me, left
me out.
So
I'm trying
to
figure that out.
I think
out
you
now.
Left me out, you know, so the whole church is cracked up. Anyway.
I love you all. While the world looks down on me as I struggle on, they say I've got nothing. Oh, but Lord, they're so wrong. My heart's full of joy. Oh, I wish they could see. Thank you, Jesus, for the blessings you give me. There's a roof above me and a place to lay my head. There's biscuits on the table and bacon in the pan. Then there's your love, Lord, and all my family. Thank you, Jesus, for the blessings you give me.
Amen.
No, I don't have much money. My clothes are always worn. It does not really matter, 'cause Lord, I have you. Yes, that's all that really matters, though the world just can't see. Thank you, Jesus, for the blessings you give me. There's a roof above me and a place to lay my head. Biscuits on the table and bacon in the pan. Then there's your love, Lord, and all my family. Thank you, Jesus, for the blessings you give me. Thank you, Jesus, for the blessings you give me. Love thanking the Lord for his blessings. And I got one more song to do if it's okay.
Yeah,
that I'd like to do if it's okay.
I want to tell you, Tim wrote both of these songs.
He shares so many things with us, so many blessings, and I wish I was worthy enough to catch every one of them. But the few that I do catch, I just love him for them, because they're all big. Just to get up out of bed in the morning and greet the day is just what a Lord we live for. What a Lord we serve. That's what I should say. I'm calling on you, Lord. Having to hold, I'm calling on you, Lord, to save my poor soul. I'm calling on you, Lord, please take my hand and let me join angel band. My life here on earth, Lord, is such a shame, full of sin and sorrow. I'm bound in chains. I can never be free. Come in to the mansion you built me in glory land. I'm calling on you, Lord, having to hold. I'm calling on you, Lord, my poor soul. I'm calling on you, Lord. Please take my hand and let me join the angel band. I know I'm not worthy, Lord, to seek your face. I need you today, Lord. Please hear my plea. Let me follow the footsteps you made for me. This is my prayer, Lord.
I'm waiting to hear that name you got for me.
I'm going to give it to her.
Oh.
Brother Gabe, what was that music instrument?
A marimbula.
He did remember it.
He did.
Yeah, 5 minutes hasn't gone by yet.
That's a miracle.
That's a miracle.
Well, praise the Lord, everyone.
Amen.
Good to be here tonight. Good to see all of you tonight and hear the testimonies. And Brother Tim, you wrote both of those songs?
I did.
Well, bless your heart. That's great. That's makes them even that much more special, then.
Thank you, Gary.
Songs from the heart.
Yes.
Songs from the Lord.
That's where they came.
Through the heart. That's right. I hope y'all enjoyed the service this morning. I think everybody was kind of touched by our service today, this morning. And it was a unique communion service, wasn't it? It was kind of different from, I guess I've never been in one quite like that. And had some people join the church this morning and never had that happen during a memorial communion service. I hope you remember one thing from this morning, from our scripture text, and that's how important it is to know for yourself.
Amen.
Yourself. You don't owe anyone else an explanation. You need to owe yourself an explanation for what you believe. And that's important that we remember that from what we studied this morning. And we're going to carry on that thought. If y'all have your Bibles, you can all go ahead and turn to the book of 1 John. I do have some scriptures we want to give out. I've got four scriptures. Who wants to read? Melissa, I need you to read 1 John chapter 2, verses 3 through 5. Jeremiah, you want one? I thought you did. 1 John chapter 2, verses 21 through 23. Vicki and Sarah, I'm going to let you have the last one. 1 John chapter 3, verses 2 and 3. And Sarah, I'm going to give you 1 John chapter 3, verse 14. You have to read loud for us tonight. But before we get into those readings, I'd like you to know that Randy will be here next Wednesday night, and there will be a revival services at Center Hill starting after they start tonight, and we'll go through the end of the week. And I'll be preaching in those revival services Tuesday and Wednesday, the 19th and the 20th at 7 p.m. And if y'all want to go, but like I said, Randy will be here at 6 o'clock Wednesday night for our regular Bible study. There will be no Bible study the Wednesday before Thanksgiving, which is a week from this Wednesday. So
y'all
be the 26th, right? Yeah. There'll be no Wednesday night service the Wednesday night before Thanksgiving, because I assume AD's gonna be cooking, so we need to give him time to cook. So just those reminders for you. I want to start off, before we get into those texts that we have, I want to read to you from 1 John chapter 1. Yeah, I encourage you, if you have never read the book of 1 John, it's not a very long book. 1st, 2nd, and 3rd John are kind of short. Tear into them. Read them, underline, study, chew them up, swallow them, digest them, eat them, because it's really, really good teachings from John. And John, the letters of John are ever been as good as the Gospel of John, which is my favorite gospel. And him and James both put it on our level, and that was to understand. I want to read to you before we start with the other scriptures, chapter 1, verses 1 through 5 through 9. Listen to what this says. He says, "This then is the message which we have heard of him and declare unto you, that God is light, and in him is no darkness at all." Did y'all see that? No darkness at all in him. "If we say that we have fellowship with him and walk in darkness, we lie." Mm-hmm. Blunt. I like blunt in my scripture, don't y'all?
Ain't no mistake in there.
Ain't no argument with that, is it? He said what he said, and he means what he means. He said, if you say that you have fellowship with him and you walk in darkness, we lie. And notice he don't say you, he says we. Mm-hmm. Okay? Make sure you understand that. He's not pointing fingers at everybody. He's including himself in every bit of this. Because see, no matter what you think about these men and their relationship with Jesus and how they walked with Jesus, they were still sinners. They still did wrong. They don't record everything they did wrong, just like you don't need to tell everything you do wrong. But God sees all. So these are the words that he's given us, not to point a guilty finger at us, but to encourage us that we're all in this together. We, okay? And so he says, where was I? Here we go. If we walk in the light as he is in the light, we have fellowship, how? With each other. You want to know how important the fellowship of the church body is? When you have fellowship with one another, when you have camaraderie with one another, when you have love with one another, when you can come together, rejoice, and laugh, and get along together, that says volumes about who you are in Christ Jesus. Amen? Not only as a church, but as an individual. When the individuals can come together and enjoy the company of other saints, that's a good sign. Amen? He said, because as we walk in the light, as he is in the light, we have fellowship with one another, and the blood of Jesus Christ, his Son, cleanses us from how much sin? That's important too. So he's talking about we, he's talking about our fellowship, he's talking about forgiveness of all sin, every bit of it. And then he says, if we say then that we have no sin, we're deceiving our own selves. That's what he says. He ain't bragging about sinning. He's saying, I'm a sinner, I was born a sinner, I'm saved, and I'm still a sinner. Thank God for Jesus and the blood of Christ. Amen? Amen. You know, Tim sung a song a while ago about what we've all got to be blessed and thankful for. That is one of the most important blessings the Lord God ever gave man, was forgiveness of sins through the blood of Jesus Christ.
Amen.
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 That ought to make us all jump up and down and scream hallelujah, because that's how important it is. And he said that the blood of Christ cleanses us from all sin, every single bit of it. And then he said, and this is important too, because it's not automatic. He says, if we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. If we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sins. Amen? And to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. So, in order for us to receive this full forgiveness of sin, there has to be a confession of the sin. Now, there's a lot of people that will teach you, you need to confess it to somebody. Well, you do. Amen. There's some religions that teach that you got to go to a man and confess that sin. Now, there are sins that need a public confession. Because you can sin against another person. You have to publicly confess that sin to that other person and ask for their forgiveness. Then you go to God. But the confession of sin that he's talking about is a confession that you make to Jesus Christ, our Lord, who sees all, who knows all, who's in us all. Amen. And he knows our sin, but he wants us to confess it. What's the importance of that? There's a thing called humility where we have to go to him and say, I did this. Forgive me for it. Okay? He already knows you've done it. But he requires you to tell him. Now, how many of y'all in here are mamas and daddies and grannies and grandpas? How many of you have ever found out that the kids or the grandkids did something? You already knew they did it. But you gave them a chance to tell you what they had done. Has that ever happened to any of y'all? Ask Melissa if I ever did that. When I found out she had done wrong, I got all the information I could. And I just heard the other two, too. And I would say, you got something you want to tell me? Oh, no. And I would bring in a little bit more information. I said, well, what about this? Oh. And after a period of time, they realized something. And usually when I started questioning them, I already knew the answers. That's the way God does us. He already knows the answer, but he wants to give you a chance to confess it. Now, here's the way I work that out with my kids. If they told me the truth, their punishment was light. But if they lied to me, their punishment was severe. Amen?
Amen.
Do you think God's any different from that? God wants us to confess our sins in totality and in honesty and truthfulness. He can stand the bitter truth because he saw it. Amen? And then he is faithful and just, the Bible says, to forgive you of that sin because of what? The blood of Jesus Christ. Thank God for the blood of Jesus Christ. And so he says he'll do this for us. So this scripture here, this little short passage has got a big, big message in it. I just jotted down a few examples of what it said to me. And one, the message, the first message I got out of it is God is light. There is no darkness in him at all. If we say we have fellowship and walk in darkness, we lie. Those are pretty simple truths, aren't they? If we say we have no sin, we lie. Amen? And if we confess, he will forgive. That's important. So we already know If we don't have fellowship with one another and walk in darkness, we're not who we say we are. Why? Because he's light. And he can't be in you without you exhibiting the light. Okay? And so he says that. He says that there's no fellowship or God is light and in him is no darkness. If we say we have fellowship and walk in darkness, we lie. If we say we have sin, no sin, we lie. And if we confess, he will forgive. Now, in a little while, he's actually going to word this where you think that you shouldn't sin. And you shouldn't sin. But he's already said that we all do sin. Okay? But he's also said that for forgiveness of sin. Now, how does God forgive us of our sins? How does he forgive us? Does he, I'll get you back later? Boy, aren't you glad for that?
Remember them as far as the east is from the west.
There you go. He takes that sin away. He casts that sin away from you. It's gone. Is there a consequence for that sin? Yes. Oftentimes, the consequence remains, but forgiveness is there. Okay? And that consequence of sin is not punishment from God. It's a result of your sin against God. Okay? So don't get that mixed up, because a lot of people think, well, God forgave me, so I shouldn't have any consequence. Really? There's always a consequence to any sin. Is the consequence begins when you sin. Okay? And it goes, even when you're forgiven, that consequence remains. Is that confusing to anybody? Okay. So, God, that's the way God is with us. He forgives us that sin. He don't bring it up anymore against us. But the consequence of that sin remains. So we still have to go through that. Now, how do we know these things? How do we know that we know? Well, John gives us some, and I just got four of them written down. There's a lot more than four. But he gives us some things that we need to know about ourselves to help us to know that we know him. Okay? Melissa, you got John, 1 John chapter 2, verse 3 and 5. 3 through 5, would you read that for me, please?
3 through 5?
3 through 5 of chapter 2.
And hereby we do know that we know him if we keep his commandments. He that saith, I know him, and keepeth not his commandments, is a liar, and the truth is not in him. But those whoso keepeth his word, in him verily is the love of God perfected. Hereby know we that we are in him.
Okay, so he uses the word we do know, I know, and hereby know we. All three of those phrases in those three verses. Okay? And what is the first? I know that I know him if I do what? Keep his commandments. Now, that puts a lot of pressure on all of us, doesn't it?
Amen.
Amen? How many of y'all have never broken a commandment? AD was saying, let me, no. Yeah. None of us raised our hand, did we? So, since we have broken the commandment, does that mean we don't know him? It doesn't mean that, does it? Why? Because he's already told us that we are all sinners, and if we say we're not, we're a liar. But he's also told us that when we confess these sins, we're forgiven. Okay? That is how we remain pure in Christ Jesus. By the confession and the receiving of forgiveness from the Lord makes us holy, makes us pure in the eyes of God. We have to be pure in the eyes of God. This is the way we obtain pureness. Okay? Yes, ma'am.
Can I just say, I know that he knows, and he knows I know that I know. I know he knows that I know he knows, and I know that Jesus loves me.
Amen. And that's a lot of I knows in there. And then he read the book of John before he wrote that, I can promise you that. Because this book of 1 John is full of I knows and we knows and we ought to knows and hereby we know and all these knows. But he says, so you have to keep his commandments. He that saith, I know him, and keepeth not his commandments is a liar. And the truth is not in him.
Amen.
Now there's lots more pressure on us now. So what are we supposed to do? We are supposed to, you know what, the way I see a lot of people, well, I've done broke these commandments, I'm about to keep on shattering a few more. And we live a reckless life, violating the laws of God, and thinking, I can't help myself. But that's not true. You can help yourself if you know him. You can help yourself. If the Spirit of God dwells in you and you know him, you can help yourself. Okay? And so, because he says, but whosoever keepeth his word, that's the commandments, in him verily is what? The love of God, and I like this, perfected. It don't say that the word of God in you is perfect. It said it is perfected. All right, you see the difference? That means it's an ongoing process. That you may not be perfect right now, but you're after that. You're striving for that. And the more you learn and the more you learn about God, the more experience you have with God, the greater your relationship with God, the more you know about the Word of God. Listen to me. The more you know about the Word of God, the more God holds you accountable to the Word you know. Now listen to that. Does that mean that he don't hold you accountable to the Word you don't know? No. You're held accountable to all the Word. But as you know the Word, and God makes a remark, I can't remember what book it's in, that he said that the ignorance of man at one time he winked at. I think it's in Hebrews. But he don't wink at ignorance anymore. Because Christ has come, given us his Holy Spirit, leads us into truth, helps us to understand the Word of God. We don't have to have the prophet and the priest to explain it to us. Jesus Christ, and through his Spirit, will give us understanding, because in the last days he speaks to us through his Son. And when you have his Son, you have the understanding, so you know these commandments, you're able to understand these commandments, and that's the way you know that you have truth. Okay? And then he says, but you keep the word in him, verily is the love of God perfected, hereby know we that we are in him. If the love of God is not in you, God's not in you.
Amen.
Amen? If the love of God's not in you, you don't have God. Because he is absolute love. We read that this morning. He is love. And so if you have God in you, you have love in you. And that is the way you are perfected, by loving God and having the love of God. Now, what is the display of the love of God in our lives? How does that show in our lives? Oh, y'all are quiet tonight. No ideas?
How we treat others.
Who said that? That's right. How we treat each other is a display of the love of God in our lives. What we expect God to do for us, we need to display that same love for others and do those very things for others. If we want forgiveness, we got to forgive. If we want mercy, we got to give mercy. Amen?
Amen?
If we want to judge people, we might as well get ready. We're going to be judged according to the way we judge someone else. Now, y'all listen to me, because I'm not making this stuff up. That is the way the love of God is displayed in us, is how much we resemble God when it comes to dealing with other people. That's the reason he says in these verses that I read earlier to you, that which we have seen and heard declare we unto you, that we also may have fellowship with us. We got to have fellowship with one another. That is the display of the love of God in a man and a woman's heart, when they have the fellowship and the love for each other. Okay? That's the love of God on display. You're supposed to feel that in this church, by the way. Amen? You're supposed to feel love and fellowship here, because that's God. And that's the way it's perfected. Let's move on. All right, the next one is 1 John chapter 2, verses 21 and through 23. Jeremiah, you got that one?
I have not written unto you because ye know not the truth, but because ye know it, and that no lie is of the truth. Who is a liar but he that denieth that Jesus is the Christ? He is Antichrist that denieth the Father and the Son. Whosoever denieth the Son, the same has not the Father, but he that acknowledges the Son has the Father also.
Okay, so he starts off this in verse 21, that I have not written unto you because you know not the truth, but because you do know the truth. Okay? Now, how do we know the truth? Because the truth dwells in us. Jesus Christ is the way, the truth, and the life. When he dwells in you, you know the way to him, you know the truth, and you have eternal life from him, and an abundant life here. So this is what he's trying to display, and this is something that John actually wrote in his gospel. Amen? And he's putting it on full display right here. And he says, but because you know it, that and that no lie is of the truth. You cannot make a lie truth. Now I'm going to add something to that. You can't make a half-truth truth. It's also a lie.
Half-truth is a full lie.
Absolutely. Amen? And the devil works in half-truth. Amen? He works in half-truth. He adds to, he takes away, and from the Word of God, to make it appear to say what it does not say.
It's a counterfeit.
It's a counterfeit gospel is what the devil offers us. And so he says, who is a liar but he that denieth that Jesus is the Christ? Who's going to be doing that? the spirit of Antichrist. When Antichrist comes, you know who people are going to believe he is? They're going to believe he is the Christ. Amen? Because there's a whole bunch of people that don't believe that the Christ has already come here. There's a whole bunch of people who don't believe in Messiah, Jesus Christ. Amen? And lots more than you think. And so when this false Christ, this liar that don't know truth, he may know the truth, but he's never going to give it to you. He's going to give you the lying version of him because he wants you to think that he is the Christ, and he's called Antichrist that denies the Father and the Son. Okay? Now, I don't know if I ever told you this before, but the Antichrist and Satan is someone who likes to resemble God. He's a counterfeit, somebody said a while ago. All right? And just as there is a Father, Son, and Holy Ghost, there's going to be a semblance of that with Antichrist. There's going to be Satan, the Antichrist, and the false prophet. Amen? There's a trinity of evil that's going to try to take the place of trinity of truth. Now think about this. And this spirit says there is no Christ. Christ has not come. You're looking at him. The lie. That's the great lie of the world that most of the world, all of the world at that time, is going to fall for. All but a few is going to fall for that lie. They are going to believe him. Isn't that amazing that that's going to happen? You know, and a lot of people say, well, where are we at? I hope.
Amen.
Yeah. I hope we're gone. Amen. I hope we're gone. And so he says, and whosoever denieth the Son, the same hath not the Father, but he that acknowledges the Son hath the Father also. When you proclaim the lovely, beautiful, holy name of Jesus, you proclaim the Father also. Mm-hmm. And how do you do that? It's amazing, the Trinity of God. You do it through the Spirit. Amen. So and it's a beautiful thing when you look at it in Scripture, how it relates to all of us. And you know, we studied in the book of St. John several times that the Father draws us into a relation with the Son, who saves us, who gives us his Spirit, who causes us to glorify the Son, which glorifies God. It's just a big circle of glorification, and it's all done through the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit in us. We're important to God. Did you know that? We are his bride. We are betrothed to him. Okay? That's how important we are to him. All right, I got to move on, I know. 1 John chapter 3, verses 2 and 3. Who's got that? Vicki.
Me. Beloved, now are we the sons of God, and it doth not yet appear what we shall be. But we know that when he shall appear, we shall be like him, for we shall see him as he is. And every man that hath this hope in him purifies himself even as he is pure.
I love this because he's talking about Antichrist. And then he goes on, and we didn't read all of that. He talks about the promises and the things that are written concerning the evil that tries to seduce you, and that we can't be ashamed. And he talks about his coming and all that. And then in this chapter 3, he begins to talk about what looks to me like the rapture of the church, where he's talking about that we are now sons of God, and it does not yet appear to us what we shall be. Now think about that. You're not, right now, you're not who you're going to be. Are you glad about that or sad about that? You better be glad, because who you're going to be is who he wants you to be. Now think about that. He says, and it doth not yet appear what we shall be. John didn't even want to jump and tackle this because he hadn't experienced this yet. So he's talking about something future in his life. Excuse me. And so he says, but we know, and that our words again, but we know that when he comes back, or when he shall appear unto us, amen, this thing I do know, I'm going to be like him. Amen?
Amen.
Isn't that a beautiful scripture right there? I'm going to, when he comes back, I don't know what I'm going to be, but I know this. When he shall appear, we, he keeps using this we because it's us. It's not him. It's us. It's all of us. It's not me. It's all of us. We shall be like him. And for the first time and since we have been saved, we are going to know who he is. Amen? See, we only know, I don't even know how to put this, almost like a fairy tale image of Christ. John had the pleasure of laying in his chest. Amen? He had that pleasure. But he knew, because he encounters him in Revelation, he don't even know who this guy is. He has to tell him who he is. And so he says, I know this, when we shall see him, we shall see him as he is. Now what does he look like? He is light. In him is no darkness at all. When you see him, you're going to see the brilliance of, and the purity of holiness and righteousness, and it's going to blow your mind. But that's not the best part. The best part is we're going to be like him. Amen. Isn't that worth living for Jesus for? Isn't this little short life, 70, 80, 90 years, worth giving it all to be in eternity, to be like him? Mm-hmm. Amen. That's what this is all about. And he says, and every man that hath this hope, listen to this, in him purifies himself. And what he's saying, so this thing that you know for sure that you got it, it would behoove you to, whatever it takes in your life, whatever you have to give up, whatever you have to turn your back on, whatever you have to ignore, to purify yourself for this moment when he shall appear to you. Whew. Boy.
That's like giving up a penny to get $1 billion.
Absolutely. Yeah. Yeah. I've got 30 cents in my pocket. You can have it now. If you wait a few years, I'll give you $30 million. What are you going to do?
Yeah. Give up for 30 cents. Yeah.
Anyway, that's what he's saying. Every man that has this hope in him purifies himself. Why does he want need to purify himself? Because he, the one that shall appear, is pure. Yeah. And we want to try our best to be like him now. Mm-hmm. But when he does appear, we are going to be like him. Amen. Isn't that a wonderful thing?
Amen.
Amen. One more. We're fixing to call it quits. 1 John chapter 3, verse 14. Sarah Barra, give us a read.
We know that we have passed from death unto life because we love the
brethren.
Brethren, he that loveth not his brother abideth in death.
Okay, them hard words for 10-year-old, aren't they? All right. But you get it?
Yeah.
Look at the scripture again. What does it start off? We know. We know. He says, these things that he's writing to us, he said, we know. There's no doubt. There's no guesswork. These are things we know. We know that we have passed from death unto life. Well, how do we do that? Jesus said that he that believeth on me, I'll give him eternal life. Amen? So we pass, if we know Jesus, if we know we're saved, if we know the Lord dwells in us, if we know these things without a doubt, then we know that we have passed from death to life. We will not die. Now you say, well, I know better now. The people die all the time. He's talking about your soul. And he ain't talking about the death of the body. He's talking about the death of the soul, because the second death is the death of the soul when it's cast away from God and God's no longer in that person's life ever again for eternity. That's the second death that he's talking about. Okay? You know what death is? What the Bible, the definition of, from the Bible of death is absence of God. That's why you can be dead in your sins and trespasses. If you're not saved, you're already dead because you're absent from God. And in eternity, if you go into eternity lost, the second death is that he cast you into eternity of hell without him. The absence of God is the second death also. So think about that. So he says, we have passed from death unto what? Life. Because we know him, he's given us eternal life. And we're going to be like him when he shows back up. Amen. That's what the resurrection is going to look like, by the way. Amen. When he shows back up and he shouts and them graves are going to open up. Hallelujah. And dead in Christ going to rise first. That's what he said. Some people say the graves are going to burst open. The scripture don't actually say that, does it? But it says the dead in Christ is going to rise. I don't know how that's going to happen without them bursting open, but if he wants it to, it'll happen. Mm-hmm. Amen? I just know that those people who are dead are coming up. And they're going to have their souls reunited with those perfected bodies that are like Christ's body. Amen. So let me move on. And so we know that we have passed from death into life because, how do we know? Because we have loved the brethren. Did you see that? There it is again. Why does he keep saying that? Why does he keep saying that we have to have fellowship, and we have to love one another, and we have to love the brethren? Why does he keep repeating that over and over? You think he gets tired of it? I can tell you why. Because it's absolutely imperative that we understand and know that we have to love one another. Because that is what we said a while ago. The love of God is perfected in us because we do that to each other. Okay? And so, because we love the brethren, now look at the way he finishes this. He that loveth not his brother abideth in death. And what did we say death meant a while ago? Absence of God. He that loveth not his brother, in other words, does not have God in their lives. That gives us a whole different new outlook on how we're supposed to treat one another, doesn't it?
Brother Gary, read the next verse, 15.
Okay. Whosoever hateth his brother is a murderer, and ye know that no murderer hath eternal life abiding in him.
I think about all the people that are murdering babies, innocent babies.
Absolutely. Absolutely, and don't you think that's not murder? It is the taking of the life of the most innocent among us, the most defenseless among us, and there will be vengeance from God. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. The love of God. If everybody had the love of God, we wouldn't have abortions right now.
Amen.
Wouldn't have any of that junk right now. But our word today and now is to know that we know Christ, to make sure that in ourselves, in our own minds, in our own hearts, we know without a doubt, I know Jesus. You, just make it personal to yourself. I need to know and make sure I know it's that important. Because if you don't have that, all of this other stuff ain't gonna happen for you. Amen. Something to think about in it. And we do know that we are sinners. We do know we're going to make mistakes. That means sometimes fellowship will be broken. There will be an appearance of not love. There will be appearance of hatred. But when you continue those things, that is a sign that you may not have the love of God in you. So we have to come to grips and to terms with those things and purify ourselves For him. We do all of this for Jesus, not for ourselves, but for Jesus. Because we want to impress him. Amen. Any questions or comments?
You look at verse 13 in chapter 5. That you may know that you have eternal life. Not just hope so, think so, feel like it, or anything. So that's what makes Christianity different from false religions and teachings.
Yeah.
That we can know for sure.
And that's been the thought process of the whole day. So to with me, what the Lord has given me, that we, it's the most important thing that I can relay to you from him, is that you need to know. And if you know that, you're good. But you need to continue on in the work that he's given you. And the work, the word has given us all to live a particular way to please him. And yes, we're going to fail. But when we do, we confess and move on. I told somebody this morning, I said, you know, we all mess up. When you mess up, don't stop. Don't stop. Don't stop living for Jesus. We all mess up. We all do things we're ashamed of. We all do things we have, wish we hadn't done. But confess it, give it to him, get forgiveness for it, and get up and walk again in him. That's what you do. That's the way you keep on living for Jesus. We stumble, we fall, but we get up and we keep following him. Amen. You know the beautiful thing about Christ? Yes, sir.
Every time we mess up, we need to use it as a learning moment. Learn not to do things. Turn it over to him and go on.
I like to think about following somebody. I like to think about a little child that's walking and they don't want you to really help them. I think about Lana, how she'll walk behind me and walk behind all of us walking around the yard. And she walks and she'll follow you. But when she falls down, what do? I stop. And when she gets up, she takes off and I start again. That's the way Christ does us. He don't leave us. He waits on us to get up, do what he's asked us to do, and come on. We got a place called glory to get to. Amen. Hallelujah. We serve a wonderful Savior. And sometimes we make him look like a villain. But he's not. He loves us more than you can imagine. He wants you to be with him. He wants you to be there with him in glory. He's there right now preparing us a place so you can be where he is. That's his hope. That's what he wants. He wants us there. In order to do that, we got to know. We got to know that we got eternal life. And pursue him. Just this way. And like I said, sometimes we're going to fall over, get back up, shake the dust off, and keep following Jesus. Amen.
Amen.
God bless you all. Tim and Sherry, thank y'all for your singing tonight.
Thank y'all for having us.
Beautiful.
Thank y'all.
We stand, please. We'll have a time of invitation. You know, you had a chance this morning to make sure you know that you know. And tonight's the same invitation. No. Make sure you know. It ain't no gonna do you any good to live this life hoping and thinking. You gotta know. Say, I know I'm saved is not an arrogant thing to say. It's a glorious thing to say. Because you say, I know I'm saved because I know my Savior. His name is Jesus. And he has saved me. And he lives in me. Getting out early tonight, so go home, get you a good night's sleep, and get ready to rip tomorrow. Maybe the Lord will come tonight and we just go to heaven. How'd that
be? Amen.
That'd be wonderful, wouldn't it? That'd be great. Love y'all. Don't forget our announcements. Don't forget next Wednesday night to be here at 6:00. If you're going to be here for Randy, you want to come to a Bible Tuesday and Wednesday night, or Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, and Friday, however y'all want to go. 7:00 at Center Hill Baptist Church. And so we'd love to have you there too. And he told me if any of y'all want to come sing, just bring your music and come on. He's going to let you sing. So if y'all want to do that too. All right. I love y'all.
And Sunday we're having our Thanksgiving.
Next Sunday, Thanksgiving meal. Anita's got everything written in red. That means if you don't bring it, she's going
to
cut you.
Undecided on what to bring, just talk to me.
Yeah, if you don't know what you want to bring, just ask around and they'll give you a selection there. You just bring what you want to. How's that sound? That sounds good too, don't it? I ain't ate nothing out here yet that didn't taste good. Y'all all get cooked. All right. Love y'all very much. Brother Sam, would you dismiss us, please?
Now, Father, once again, we do thank you for your words that you brought us this evening. Those reports of service to service. Lord, we always ask that you'd always give us the ears to truly hear what your word has to say and to be able to put it into practice and do like what's been preached to us today, to examine ourselves and make sure about our calling and election that truly we have put our trust, our faith in Jesus Christ, not depending upon our good works, or church membership, or holding out or anything, but it's faith in Jesus Christ. Lord, you know the ones that's on the prayer list. You know what all their needs are. We just ask you to bless and meet them according to your will. Forgive us as we head out and head separate ways. Ask it all in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Amen.